because we're stronger together.
Brought to you by Empire Industries Property Management, built for investors by investors. For more information about this show, please visit our website, selfmanagemyproperty.com, home of the ultimate landlord survival handbook.
Now, the Landlord Survival Show with your host, Steve Rosenberg.
Hey everyone, this is Steve Rosenberg, the host of the Landlord Survival Show. This is the show that we talk about when basically the gurus stop talking and the rubber meets the road, and we want to discuss the real challenges that investors deal with and what the real investors are doing out there on a daily basis, out there grinding, working, trying to figure out basically all the stuff that they sell you on the idea, but they don't actually come through with the end results. So the concept of this show is very simply to do our best as investors to help fellow investors get through the trials and tribulations day in and day out that we all deal with, trying to find the, you know, just a easier way to get through this maze of people trying to sell you stuff and people trying to tell you the easy way and all these, you know, trying to figure out who's telling the truth, who's not, what works for you based on your goals and what doesn't. And the reason we created this is owning a property management company, we realized that not everyone is wanting property management. But a lot of people want to have real estate. And what we've learned is the people that want to have real estate, they know that that is the true road to wealth, but they don't know how to get the road to wealth. They know it's owning real estate or being involved in real estate at some level. And we've had many, many guests on the show that have much different variations of how to be successful in real estate. And for the ones that want to own real estate, what they want to do is they want to make sure that they have some form of plan. And a lot of people will come to us and, you know, they'll say, you know, Steve, I don't really want property management, but I want to know, how do I, what is a make ready? What does that actually mean? And if I have to do an eviction, I only do one every year or every 2 years or every 5 years. So I just need some sort of reference. So because of that, Pete and I, my business partner, created what we call the Ultimate Landlord Survival Handbook. And what that is, the Ultimate Landlord Survival Handbook is basically us creating a reference guide for the average investor so that they know, what does it take to vet a vendor? What does it take to get a property rented? What does it take to do a make ready? The things that you don't deal with every day, but for us managing almost 1,000 properties, we deal with on a constant basis. So we're basically taking our knowledge and giving it to them. If you're interested in the manual, you can go to our website, selfmanagemyproperty.com, and you can go ahead and, you know, you can purchase the book. You can look at all the free forms we have there, the video blogs, the other stuff that we have. And we're trying to make it more of a community for people because we're going to talk to our guest in a second. What I have found is there's not many people out there or places out there when you are an investor to actually have that no shit conversation that says, hey, I'm having a problem. Can somebody help me with this? And again, we created a Facebook group. So we're really trying to do our best to educate investors that are similar to us that are just trying to find a way to make it work. So I've got a guest here today, very special guest with a very unique story. And the way that I met her was she and I were both speaking at an event. I believe it was in Dallas, right, Elizabeth, when we first met?
Correct.
Yeah.
That's correct. Yes.
So we were up in Dallas speaking, a great event, Propelio, a great group of guys up there. And we met up there, and I really liked her message. I liked what she had to say. I liked her story, which I think is pretty unique, especially where she just was the past, I think it was 30 days. And we're going to talk a little bit about that. Yes. So, Elizabeth, first of all, thank you for taking the time. I'm sure you're busy, especially, you know, today, today being 9/11, a lot of stuff going on, a lot of emotions. But tell everyone a little bit about yourself, who you are, what you do, and what you specialize in.
Well, good morning. Thank you, Steve, for having me on. Super excited to be on your show. And before we get into the details, I just want to just say a remembrance for all the people that lost their lives in 9/11 17 years ago. It was a very tragic situation for the entire country, and particularly for those that lost their lives and their families. So today is a day that we will definitely take some time to remember that. Me being from New York, I was very impacted and very saddened by the events, and we really we keep those people in our prayers.
Without a doubt.
So, well, my history. Well, I was a social worker before getting into real estate. I always knew that was my calling, to help others and to make a difference in the world. I always had that philanthropic feeling in me and that desire, that burning desire to go wherever I needed to go to help others. And that's what I did. I went to college, got my degree in human services, and go right into it, into social work. In the summers, I would go and help my mom because that's the line of work that she was also in. And I enjoyed it. I loved working in the social work environment. But unfortunately, and the realistic part of it is that the paycheck was so, so small. It was rewarding. It was an emotional rewarding pay, but financially, it really, really wasn't. I wasn't even living paycheck to paycheck. I was literally living, you know, payday from the payday to the following day. That's how I was living. So I knew that it wasn't secure. It wasn't fulfilling. And I really found myself in a rut, in a financial rut and an emotional rut as well. So I decided to make a change, and I had a surgery, took some time off for the summer, and decided to study to become a real estate agent. This was back in 2003. So that's where my journey as a licensed real estate agent began. However, in 2001, I did some traveling to Chicago, and I was introduced to a team of people that would wholesale, and they did everything. They kind of like what your management company does, but this is for flips. They would find the deal, get it under contract, get the rehab company going, and we just flipped like that. But it was just very passive. We weren't aggressively doing anything like mailers or anything like that. So it was just for fun, so to speak.
So let me ask you this. Did you know anyone in real estate prior to you getting involved?
I did. I did. Actually, my life partner and my business partner, he was a mortgage broker. Okay. And so he was doing, you know, he was in that realm. So he's the one he was in Chicago. He had his mortgage company in Chicago in 2001. So that's why we were doing the passive investing in Chicago.
Okay. And interesting, when I got into real estate, that's actually how I got into it is you know, what's interesting about the story, about how our stories are there's some alignment, especially with today, is, you know, the whole reason I got into real estate was because of 9/11, was because being an airline pilot, right. You know, I went from the safe, secure job of being an airline pilot to basically being sent a furlough notice and saying, you know, we don't know if this industry is even going to exist. So the illusion of having a safe, secure job was evaporated in about 4 days' time. And so that was kind of my proponent, and me not knowing anything about real estate, similar to you, I couldn't even spell real estate. I didn't know anything about it. I was studying to be a pilot my whole life. And so, you know, when you start going down that path, it's almost like, and maybe this was for you, I'm curious, but to me, it was like almost this whole new society of flipping and wholesaling and buying notes. And I'm just, you know, I felt like this kid that was just in this, you know, went through the looking glass of this new society, didn't even know where to start, what to do. The only thing I did feel was I was behind the curve. I felt like I had missed a lot of years because I didn't even know that it existed. And that, to me, was that was a burning desire for me to figure out, I've got to make this work because I'm behind the curve here. And so that was one thing that I did that I really, really needed to think about when it came to it. So let me ask you this. when you got involved in this and you started doing the flipping and wholesaling, and I kind of know what you mean, because when I got into, when I was doing the wholesaling, we were assigning options when I was doing this, which I don't even know what the term is now. Everyone seems to like want to put an acronym or a term on this. But there really wasn't anyone else doing that at the time that I could, that I knew. I mean, I learned, I actually mentored and learned from someone in California that trained me. But when I would go do this, people were like, how do you even do that? And I said, I think because I didn't know, I did it, because I didn't let the self-doubt of people telling me you couldn't do it stop me. Yes. So I did it because I was just told, this is what you do. Go do this, 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 and you'll close a deal. So I did exactly what I was told to do, and it worked. What got you out of you? I'm assuming you were living in Chicago at the time. Is that right?
I was between Chicago and Houston.
Okay.
Traveling between both cities.
So I guess the first question, what made you decide Houston over Chicago? Was it a real estate decision? Was it a life decision?
I think it ultimately, now that we look back at it, it was a real estate decision. But at that time, because the cost of living, and going further into this, my story was, I relate with you because I had no idea anything about real estate. Honestly, I was just guided and I just followed what I was told to do. But my concern was that I didn't have any sales experience. So my fear was that I don't know how to sell anything. I've never sold anything. So that was not my area of expertise. But I quickly learned that selling something was not what I was supposed to do. I was supposed to be, paying attention and listening and really, really connecting with the people that I was working with my clients, which similar to the skill set in social work.
Yeah.
So that being said, you know, we got very comfortable 2001, and in 2003, I got my real estate license. Up to 2007, I was super comfortable. We were doing fantastically well. Our main focus was retail sales and mortgages. That was it. That was our bread and butter. And then all of a sudden, you know, everything happened with, you know, everything in our industry, the recession, just everything, just literally the rug underneath our feet was pulled away from us. And it was, you know, we were very young and we were very naive and not smart with our money. We were just living an extreme lifestyle, a house in Chicago, a house in Houston, a car in Chicago, a car in Houston. I mean, just too much. We had a lot for just two young kids that really didn't have much life experience. So we would go to the grocery store, and this is something maybe not a lot of people can relate, but we would go to the grocery store and just throw anything in the cart, anything and everything. And then as of 2007, we learned what it was to budget. We learned what it was to go to the grocery store and actually make a list of things you really need, not just go crazy and throw anything in the cart and just spend wild. We learned a lot of things and we matured very, very quickly.
So, okay, let me ask you this. So you, and yes. I'm leading somewhere with this question, but when yes. you saw things crumbling beneath you and you saw that it was, you know, what you were doing was not sustainable, were you in some level in disbelief or choosing not to deal with the issue and just tried to live the life you were living, or how did you handle that?
We were living in disbelief, but not fully accepting that things had come to an end,
right?
And that a change needed to be made. So we were really struggling to maintain our lifestyle, which was not the healthiest thing. We really, really suffered a financial crisis within our, you know, not just the country, within ourselves too, because we had to pretty much sell the mortgage company, which was doing really well in Chicago, and then sell the house in Chicago because we were close to going into foreclosure. The house we had here in Houston, it was our mortgage was way too much for what we were not even making any money. We dipped into our savings and we dipped hard into the savings, which pretty much left us without savings. So it was really, really scary. But at the same time, I think it was perfect timing for us because it saved our financial life and of course our emotional life too. Because when you live in a life of excess, you don't really have appreciation for the little things, so to speak.
Yeah.
Now, yeah.
Let me ask you this. I have a similar story. That's why I'm curious. But did you guys actually have a point where you kind of just said, you know, either you were defeated or you accepted it and said, okay, you know what? This is the bottom. We've hit bottom. Now we need to figure this out. Or did something cause you to hit it? Like, was it self-imposed, or did something impose it upon you guys where it was like, cause everyone's going to have that wake up call that says, hey, this is happening whether you like it or not. Right. I mean, we all have that. And I have a similar story like that, but I'm curious how you realize that, because I'm assuming at some point you had to make a lot of conscious decisions to change your plan and change your path.
Yes. It was one of those moments where we totally hit rock bottom. That was it. There was no breathing room. We were, we were about to have the only car that we had left. It was about to get repossessed. That was, to us, was like, okay, that's it. Everything we've worked for all these years and everything, it's literally gone. And this is, this isn't life. We just can't continue like this anymore. And that was the breakthrough right there. Like, we finally woke up, realized that we were no longer in that excess world. A lot of people a lot of colleagues in the industry disappeared as well. They had to go get a job or do whatever. And it was just one of those things where, I mean, we were like, this is it. Oh my gosh, I can't believe it. And because we were very naive and not mature at that time, we were in our 30s. Yeah, we were about 30 years old. We were just not prepared for that. So there was a lot of disbelief. We were in denial, disbelief, denial. And then one of those things that it's like, oh my gosh, we need to do something right away.
Yeah. And, you know, what's interesting is what a lot of people don't think about, and I can give you, I'll give you a brief history of my story, but what a lot of people never seem to weigh, unless they've walked that walk and been in those shoes, is the mental stress and the sleepless nights and the strain that it puts on the family. And that is a huge toll that sometimes you cannot get away from moving forward in it. What happens? I'm sure at some point you probably make decisions with some of that still thinking in the back of your mind. Am I putting myself into one of these future positions? I'm sure that weighs, because that does, you know, we even have business decisions that we do or don't do because of our past experiences. So I, the one thing I tell people is, until you've walked that walk and been in those shoes, you can't tell me what is right and what is wrong and how I should think and how I shouldn't think, because that to me is the biggest thing of, you know, I had, you know, basically our story was we bought a bunch of crappy properties that were not producing. We had about, I don't know, I'd say about 35 or 40 of them. They weren't making us money. We were losing money on all of them. We thought that the only way to fix the solution was buy more of them, which seems now so idiotic, but at the time it seemed like it made all the sense in the world. And sure. And I tell people, I'm like, until you have those sleepless nights of saying, how am I going to make all these mortgages and how am I going to fix this? Because I knew that we knew that we got ourselves into this position, and it lays on you to get yourself out of the position. This is the real world, right? So I started thinking, okay, how do I get out of this? Right. And I tell people, that is a scary position to be in, because people talk about, oh, just over leverage and do this. And I'm like, you know what? Unless you've been in that position, it is not a fun place to be, because when the music stops and you're holding all the cards, it is a scary place. And I can relate to that, because I've been there. And I think that, you know, and I'm curious your opinion, but a lot of our decisions are based on with that hanging in the background. And I'm not saying it's good or bad, but it's there in our heads when we're making financial decisions.
Yes, it totally is. You hit the nail on the mark, because that's exactly how we operate nowadays. It's like, there's a fear. There's a fear of not going back there again.
Yeah.
We don't wanna be in that situation again. And our biggest mistake, or our two biggest mistakes that we made back then, and we realize that now, is that we only depended on that one stream of income, which was retail sales.
Right.
That was the worst.
Yeah.
Because we were just passively investing, we were really aggressive about it. we really couldn't rely on that. So that was, you know, once everything went downhill, that was in a standstill as well. And then the second one is not managing our finances properly. We just went wacky. We went crazy. We just had, it was fun times. And again, we were young, naive, not mentally prepared to how to handle making a lot of money. So we lived such an extreme lifestyle that it was just ridiculous. It really was.
And you know, I think the way to look at it and the way I look at it is, you know, like we took our lessons of our mistakes of losing, let's just say we were losing, I don't know, $30,000-$40,000 a year from having bad investment properties, to sure. taking those as lessons to now creating a company that's doing multi-million dollars in property management. So to me, it's kind of, it's almost like it was like a learning curve. It was a college, a stupid tax, whatever you want to call it. But obviously it only works if you take the lesson that it's giving you. If you don't take the lesson, like you said, if this happens to you and you put yourself in the same position again, it's like, well, that's on you because you did it. If you take that and say, you know what? We learned this lesson. This is what we will not do again. Not out of fear, but out of logic and out of, you know, sheer, you know, planning and having a strategy, then it was worth it at some level.
That's right. And I think that's why, like, for us to take a vacation or to go away for such a long time, it's very difficult because we worked so hard to build what we have now, you know, and even though it can run by our businesses can run on their own and everything can possibly go smoothly, we still have that in our minds that we don't want to lose everything. You know, do you see what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. So let's flash forward now a little bit and tell me what are you guys doing now? And, you know, I know you just got back from a I would say a vacation, but it didn't sound like it was a vacation. It sounded like you were working. So I'm curious to hear about that as well. So tell everyone kind of where, you know, let's to today, what did you do with all that information and knowledge and experience and scars? And what are you doing now?
Okay, so now, yes, fast forward, totally different lifestyle. We live with a quarter of expenses that we did last time around, you know, the first time around. We live very comfortable, but we are not excessive anymore. We're very cautious about that. And we have multiple business within what is real estate investing. We do the wholesaling, we do some mentoring. We only take a very small amount of mentees a year. We do about 10 people a year because it just takes a long time. Our mentorship is 6 months. So we have that. We have the acquisition, the mentorship. We also have a construction company that does our rehabs, and we also do some rehabs for investors as well. We also have owner finance properties. I do a little bit of retail sales. That's not my main thing anymore. But I will represent buyers and sellers. I list our flips. We do flips as well. And, we have some rentals overseas.
Okay. So I'd like to talk a little bit and I want to get your opinion, which, you know, I'm a big believer. My business partner may say differently, but I try to be a big believer in focus and staying and picking a lane and staying in one lane and making that the best lane I can make. So do you agree with that concept? Because it sounds like you guys you're in the same lane of real estate, but it sounds like you guys have a lot of divisions. Do you think, I know they all kind of coincide with each other and they probably feed on each other. One feeds another. But do you think that one may take time away from another? Meaning, are you making, let's just throw numbers, are you making $50,000 here where you're losing $500,000 because you're not focusing on a bigger prize? What are your thoughts?
At first we were, and that was, we were all over the place. And even though we do cover a lot of aspects, again, because of this experience that we had in the past that we only had one soul, we relied on one. So now we're like, okay, multiple. Now it's overboard, but we have a team in place. And that's key because it's not just, you know, the two of us or three of us or four of us. We have a team that works, that we have in place that takes care of each and every one. And I focus on on one aspect of it. My partner focuses on another, and then we have people that take care of the rest. So we have tried to make it where it's pretty much works on its own, even if we're not around.
So which one of these do you think takes, which one is the best return on your time, would you say? Because I counted about four or five. And I know that mentoring, I'm going to say, if I had to guess, is probably not on the top list just because you're
it's
trading
not.
Time. You're
right.
Now, I'm sure.
It's not.
I'm going to say, and tell me if I'm wrong, because you did the social worker, some of that is creeping in to help other people. I'm guessing that's a big part of why you do that part. Is that right?
That's correct. Yes, definitely. And the fact that we speak Spanish as well. That's another reason why, because we see that there is a huge need in our Hispanic community to be guided the correct way on investing and even just listening to our story and where we come from. A lot of people can relate to a situation like that, you know, and so that's why we do it. But again, it's a very limited amount of people we do. It's not like we have an academy and have meetings every month, because you're either doing that or you're actually producing and you're actually growing your business.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's why we have a lot of people ask us, well, when are you going to have an event? When are you going to have an event? And it's like, I don't do events, because if that were the case, I would be an event planner, because that really takes up all your time.
Yeah.
So I'd rather invest my time in what is, you know, developing my business, growing my business. And pretty much where we make our money is in having our own acquisition agents, and then turning those leads into our deals for flips and for us to flip. And that's where we make our money, because even for the construction company, that's not really the most profitable, because of the fact that we pretty much, the only reason why we have these guys is because we have 35 people, you know, on our team just in the construction company. And that's to take care of our flips. But then there's times where we're not flipping. We're not flipping every single, you know, day of the month.
Right.
So we also have to occupy, because we have, if you think of it, that's 35 guys. Those are 35 families that are depending on us. So we want to make sure that they're well taken care of. And that's why we reach out to other investors to help keep our guys busy so we don't lose them.
No, that's great. That's great. So, and one feeds the other, basically. You're not doing dry cleaning. You know, you're staying in your sphere of influence with people.
Exactly.
And like you said, you're helping them. And I'm sure that you get a lot of business from other people because of what you do, whether it's a deal, whether it's a lead, whatever it is, you're getting other things because of that is my guess. Cause, you know, I'm a big proponent in helping people and giving out information. And it always seems to come back many fold over. And, you know, it's funny, the people that don't give anything always say, well, I'll give when I'm successful. It's like, don't you get it? You need to be giving in order to be successful. It's part, you don't need to be, but it's a big part of it, in my opinion. And
exactly. Yes, I agree with you, Steve. And that's huge for us. And I definitely have to make emphasis on the fact that when we started over in 2008, we had a lot of people that we met along the way, and, you know, that really guided us and helped us and didn't charge us a dime for it.
Yeah.
They saw that we were struggling. They saw that there were a lot of holes in our business, and they really did, out of the kindness of their heart, and just because you have to have that abundance mentality, that
absolutely,
if you share something, you're not losing anything, you're empowering somebody else, and you never know, along down the road, they can actually be your business partner or a colleague, or you can do business with each other, and you'll never lose that way.
Yeah,
ever.
It's so true, and it's great that you had that. Unfortunately, when Pete and I went through and bought our properties, it was almost the other way around, in the sense that nobody really helped us. We had to figure it out. And not only did we have to figure it out, we failed many, many times over. And, you know, when you're out there in the heat of battle, there's no sidelines to call a timeout on. You know, I remember when we were going through Hurricane Ike, when Hurricane Ike rolled through back in 2009, I believe. And I think we maybe had about 30 properties or so at the time. And I remember we lost like 20 roofs and we were, houses were flooded and families were displaced. And, you know, obviously a mini version of Harvey, which just took place. But, you know, I remember going through this. And, you know, we were thinking, I don't know how we're going to pay this. How are we going to pay these mortgages? How are we going to help these people with their families? Like, this is real life. And what was interesting is at one point somebody asked us, they said, what did your insurance company say? And we thought, the insurance company. We need to call them. So we call the insurance company and the insurance company says, oh, we've been waiting for you guys to call. We were thinking you should have called us by now. And we're thinking to ourselves, why don't you call us? Like, and they said, well, that's not our job. I'm like, so we got the other. So that's one of the reasons we do help so many people is because nobody was there to help us. And we think, you know what? There's probably other people just like us that maybe were not able to punch through the other side and come up with successful models and solutions. And I think it's a need. I think it's a huge need. I think that because of the internet and because of social media, the barrier to entry to get into real estate or become quote unquote a real estate expert or a flipper or wholesaler, whatever you want to call them. I think because it's so easy to become that now, I think it's easier for people to fail because there's no barrier to entry doing that. And, you know, it can be dangerous as we know. I mean, you and I probably both know many, many people that have gone down this track and have lost, whether it's family members, whether it's, you know, a job, whatever it is, relationships. It can be a very dangerous, scenario.
Correct.
So I want to talk, let's talk a little bit about where you just were. You were just out of the country. And I thought you were on vacation, but you were not on vacation. You were actually working. So let's talk about that.
We called it like a business vacation because we did have a little bit of downtime, to enjoy, but we did a lot of work over there. So we have some, I posted on my Facebook and some of you can, you know, you can follow me on my page. I'll provide the information later, but, so what we did is that what we have is a mixed space, commercial and residential space in Quito, Ecuador. For many that may not know where Ecuador is because it's such a small country, it's right next to Colombia. Everybody knows where Colombia is at. So it's right next to Colombia between Colombia and Peru. And so we were out there, love Quito. I mean, it's amazing, beautiful city. That's the capital of Ecuador. And so we went out there because we have rental properties. You know, these are commercial spaces for lease. Then in the back, there's residential, and we also have a rental home that we had to go take a look at because it's been vacant for a couple of months. And here goes a horror story of many that I can share with you, but this is very recent, so I'll definitely have to share. So these rental properties we own free and clear. And 2 years ago when we were out there, we left tenants in place. We had tenants from years and years and years, 10 years, 8 years, 7 years, and everything was running smoothly. We made the huge mistake, and we know better, right? Because we're in this industry, we know better, but we left a relative to manage the properties. And I say manage because that's what the agreement was and didn't happen. But anyhow, so we appointed a relative to manage the properties and it was just chaos, complete chaos, huge mistake. Again, we know better, but because, you know, this relative had some free time and we thought, you know, an extra income for her would be fantastic. And it was really bad. So I will tell you that the reason why we went, it's because we have not collected rent in 1 year from any of our, from anything, from everything that we had there. It just 1 year was sitting there of rent. And we were like literally crossing our fingers that I hope these people pay up because, you know, it's been a year and we've been in touch with them, but because we've been so busy here and so much going on here, we haven't had the time to get away and go out there and see. But thankfully all the tenants paid up every
single
penny.
For the full year?
The full year.
Wow.
Yes. Unfortunately, due to the lack of administration and professionalism, because it looks really bad. You know, if you're a landlord and you don't have your things in order, and you, especially for commercial, and, you know, there were a couple of issues with, so we had one tenant that was occupying two spaces, and he had a hair salon, very successful hair salon. He had been there for 10 years, and he had some issues with water leak and things like that. And we had our relative that was
the manager
of these properties. The manager. Yes. We had her send somebody to fix it, but they did a really poor job. 2 weeks later, the issue was back again. And so what the tenant did was he took care of it on his own, and he didn't even bother telling us. And it's because he's like, I know you're overseas. I know, you know, you guys are busy, and I took care of it and all that stuff. But the news was that he was moving out. And that what to us was a big loss, because he's been with us for 10 years. So we had to go out there and see what was going on, what the condition of the property was. And it was in okay shape, thank goodness, but some repairs needed to get done. And thankfully, within a few days of us visiting the salon and checking it out and seeing when his move-out date would be, we came across the new tenant. And now he signed a two-year lease before we left.
That's great.
So we had that secured. And now we have somebody that's a professional in her field. She administers buildings in Quito, and, you know, large buildings for the American embassy, and so she knows her stuff, and now she's in charge of taking care of things. And lo and behold, she picked up rent before the 4th, which
wow.
is amazing, because our relative was picking up rent, you know, the 20th and 25th of the month. You know, that's
when they got around to it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Whenever they had time, granted, they don't have anything else to do, but that was all they were supposed to do. But, so now things are different, and we're happy. And, we left things in place. We left a house that is, currently being listed. I should be posting it very soon. They're listing it in Ecuador, and then I'm going to list it here with HAR International. But yeah, things are smoothly now. We're happy. Things are looking up.
So, okay, I got a couple questions here. So, as an airline pilot, I've been all over the world, but I've been all over South America. I've been to Quito, I've been to Guayaquil, and I'm trying to think of the name of the town. We took a tour one time from Quito, Iriquitas, is that what it's called? You go across the equator, and it's a town where it's like a market and stuff like that, about a 2 or 3 hour drive.
Right. It's at the mitad del mundo.
Yes.
Close to mitad del mundo, which is right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, okay, let me ask you this. So first of all, my first question is why South America? What made you decide as a business? Was it a business decision, or was it an emotional decision?
It was the family ties, because my business partner and life partner, his family's from Ecuador.
Okay.
So that's how he acquired these properties since he was very, very young.
Okay.
And they were part of the family. At first, like the back part of it was where he lived at, like his home when he would go visit Ecuador, because he was born in Chicago. When he would visit Ecuador, his home was in the back part of now this commercial space. And then throughout the years, they built the front part, which is the commercial space. And so now we own these now free and clear because of, you know, they've had this in the family for over 30 years.
So. Okay. So
portion of it.
So my next question just out of curiosity, can you get a loan in Ecuador? Because I know like in Brazil, you cannot get a loan. So how does that work if you want to buy property down there?
You can, but it's very complicated, super duper complicated. It takes literally like 4 to 5 months to get a loan, and you have to be a national. Us being like Americans and not having citizenship from Ecuador, we can't purchase property in Ecuador.
So, like, okay.
You have to become nationalized.
That's to own land, obviously, to get a loan, but so you have to be a citizen of Ecuador to actually purchase property down there.
Right. Or have a long-term visa
okay.
to be able to do that.
So when you have a property situation, let's say you had a regular management company or something similar to that down there, what is the process if a tenant doesn't pay rent? How do you get them out? Is there a standard eviction? Does it go through the courts? How does that work?
Oh my gosh. So here, if we think things are complicated here to get a tenant out, in South America or Latin America, it's 10 times worse. It's super difficult because it's not like you go to an entity and you file a document and you get, you know, the courts take care of it. You have to go to like 10 offices to get one document notarized, certified, acknowledged, filed, declared, and accepted. It's just, it's very chaotic. So that's why we were there. We were supposed to be there for 2 weeks. We ended up staying three because we had some issues with transferring some deeds over there. And it was quite hectic. It's not like here where you go to a title company, you take care of it all in one place.
Yeah.
So, no.
So like if somebody doesn't pay, let's say rent's due January 1, How long until you can start doing something? Is there a time frame? Like here, you know, you don't pay on the first, we start the eviction on the fourth, and I'm guessing it's probably not as expeditious as, you know, and then of course this is Texas. California is totally different and all that stuff.
Right. Over there it takes about 3 to 4 months to be able to do something about it. Yeah. Wow. So the law protects, of course, like here too, they protect the tenants, but over there it's exaggerated. I mean, because you've given them the permission to enter and to be in or habitate that property, then you're in for about 4 to 5 month ride before they can get out.
So let me ask you this. Do most people in South America, do they own the properties free and clear, or do they leverage them? What's the mindset down? You know, here, everyone's leverage. What's it down there?
Over there and in most of Latin America, people own things, I mean, free and clear. You don't have, the culture over there is not very open like we are here, where you have credit cards and you have lines of credit and you have mortgages for this and mortgages for that. Over there, it's like you buy a car, you pay it cash. You buy a house, you pay it cash. That's why it's not very enticing either to get a mortgage, because the interest rate is 14%.
Wow.
Which is absolutely, yes, it's super high.
Yeah.
So since we have a property that we're selling over there, the realtor was telling us that, so when it might take a year or two before the house sells, and it's only a $150,000 home. We're not selling anything over, you know, that exaggerated in price, but she said it may take about 2 or 3 years before you sell it. One, two, you may end up having a tenant before you get a buyer. Three, you may end up getting somebody that will ask you to owner finance. So over there, that's a pretty big exit strategy, owner finance. So they'll give you a nice down payment. Then you know, give them X amount of years to pay it at the 14%. And then, you know, like we do here. But yes, getting a loan over there is not, it's not really part of their culture, or it's frowned upon to be in debt and to get a loan.
Interesting. And you know, it's funny. I like hearing these stories because I get the opportunity to travel a lot of different places and I get to see a lot of different cultures. But, you know, a lot of people that are just into, you know, let's say Houston or some other place in the U.S. that are listening, they don't understand how well we have it. And I mean, like I tell people, I don't know of any other investment that, let's just say you do a standard conservative loan that you're putting 20 or 25% down. The bank is actually giving you 80% or 75% of the amount for that property. And they're saying, look, you just put in 20% and we're good. And so people don't realize how well we have it that, you know, having 4, 5, 6 properties, that's almost unobtainable in other cultures, in other countries. And that, you know, again, that's why I was curious about the loans, if that's because that tells me there's not a lot of people. I'm guessing either there's the people that have a lot of properties and then the ones that maybe don't, because there's probably not much in between, I'm guessing.
Right. No, it's usually you buy in Latin America, you buy a house and you're there until the very last person of your
the family, right? Goes,
family. Yeah. Passed on from grandma, grandpa to, you know, mom, dad, then the kids and the grandkids and like that. I mean, that's that it's a generational situation. So it's not like you're switching homes every 5 or 7. You know how we have that saying here? We have that 7-year itch.
Yep.
And you change, yeah. You know, you switch homes or you get, or you lease a car and you have a new one every year.
Yeah.
Over there, that's absolutely not, that's just not even,
it's not in the, it's consider. Not in the mindset. Yeah. Okay. So
exactly. And for, yeah, and for, just for conventional lending over there, it's, so like the earnest money over there, it's 30% down is what they give at first, you know, it's good faith. And then the rest is financed, but it takes about 4 or 5 months to get a loan. So, So the bank will lend you 70%, but you're looking at a 14% interest rate and they ask you anything and everything. Here, people get so frustrated with the mortgage process,
Yeah. And
it's nothing in comparison to how it's like in Latin America, because pretty much they'll drive you so crazy that you won't even want to get a loan in the end.
It's like here you'll get people saying, how dare they ask me about my last 5 years? You should only be asking me about the last 3 years of job history. It's like, you don't realize how good you have it, man. Just take the five and get the loan, you know?
We're very lucky here. We're super, super spoiled and blessed at the same time.
Yeah.
Because we have so much is at our fingertips. And I don't, you know, I wasn't raised in Latin America. I was raised here in the U.S. My parents are Mexican. They both migrated here when they were very, very young. But I don't, there is no excuse for anybody in this country not to make it, you know, because you have moments like you and I that we have the experience of where you have that reset button where you can restart and make things new again. And like you said, if it happens to you a second time, then that's on you because you weren't prepared, because you've gone through this before. But there's absolutely no excuse not to make things happen. If you have a dream, a desire, you can start small. A lot of people get so bogged down with the big details that, like, for example, people that want to get in the industry in real estate investing, they get so into the name of the company and creating the best website.
The entity and yeah.
Doing their branding and getting the best business cards, but they have absolutely zero business. And it's like, why don't you worry about getting your business first,
it's like,
you know, getting business first? And then you can do all that fancy stuff.
Yeah, it's funny. I get people all the time. So as an example, my son recently, he was 14 years old and he bought a rental property. And he came to me and said, Dad, I want to buy a rental property. And so, you know, I said, okay. And we went through the conversation and, you know, I said, well, how much money do you have? And he said, well, I've got $10,000. And I'm like, first of all, how'd you get $10,000 was my first question. I'm like... He said, well, I've been saving it. I've been saving the money. And he says, you know, I listen to all of your audio books all the time. And, you know, he listens to part of his chores is he has to listen to Grant Cardone. That's part of his chores. And he listens to books and stuff like that. And, you know, he's in the car with me, Andy Frisella, and all these other people that I listen to. And I said, well, you don't have enough. And so the one thing he said to me, he says, well, then how do I do it? There's got to be a way to do it. How do I do it? And I thought, well, that's a good question. I said, well, I said, you can save the money more. I said, you're about halfway there. You can save it. He said, well, I'm 14. That means I'll be 28. He said, that's too long. I said, okay. I said, well, then you can get a partner.
Wow.
And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, you can partner with someone. I said, you know, you split the deal. Maybe they come in with half the money and you split the deal. I said, so you need to find someone you can partner with. And he said, well, Dad, I'm 14. I don't know anyone else that has the money. And I said, well, you got to think. And so I'm trying to see where he's going with this. So then he comes back to me and he says, well, would you partner with me? And I said, well, what are the terms? And he says, well, let's do 50-50. And I said, okay. I said, we'll do 50-50. That works. So my whole point of all this is when I tell people the story, I get people asking, well, he's 14 years old. He can't get a loan. And I'm like, you're missing the point of the education process that I'm giving him. The education process is that this kid is 14 years old and he's thinking on his own how to buy real estate. How you do it, like you said, he's not worried about the website and this. Pick up the phone, call 500 people, and let's see if you get a deal. When you get a deal, then we'll worry about the rest. And that's, I think, the lesson here that I've learned is – It doesn't have to be perfect. It's got to be consistent. And, you know, right. A lot of these people, and I think you and I are true testament to this, that, you know, we basically changed courses in our lives, whether we wanted to or not, whether it's a matter of circumstances, whatever the case may be. At the end of the day, we had that no shit moment where we said, you know what? This isn't working. I got to do something else. And you know what? I'm not going to listen to what people tell me I can't do. I'm just going to do it. And what's funny is after people say, well, how'd you do it? And you tell them, they go, well, you can't do that. It's like, funny, because I just did it for the last year and I'm pretty successful at it. So, you know, it's right. And I like when people tell me, well, I want to flip and I want to wholesale, but I'm a bad salesperson. I say, well, how many sales calls do you make? Well, I don't make any. I go, well, make 500 sales calls. And if you still suck at that point, then maybe I would agree you suck and you shouldn't do this. But if you're not trying to get better, then what's the, right. You know what I mean? And so that I yeah, think is totally. The biggest challenge. So let me ask you this. You probably get a lot, like myself, we get a lot of people that come and ask us, what advice do you give newer investors that are trying to get into this? What do you tell them? Hey, look, man, this is the one thing that you got to do that's a you know, non-negotiable.
I think that you have to they really have to ask themselves, do they really, really, how bad do they really want it? Because when you're hungry and you really, like with us, when we had to start over and we were very hungry and didn't have much, you just go or you don't. And same with your son, you know, 14 years old, that's very incredible. I mean, that's what better message and what better lesson than that? A 14-year-old to want to do something that's not many at that age, first of all, think that way or have the drive or the desire. And that's where I see a lot of new investors fail, is they don't have the drive or the desire. They do it because they think it's, and I've seen it, it's really, really sad. I'm going to admit it, but a lot of people think it's cool, that it looks really neat, and it's just something fun. And it's like, it's all fun and games until it's not.
Yeah.
Until you buy bad properties, until you buy bad deals,
yep.
Until, you know, you're losing money. And so I think that's the first thing. I mean, what drives you to do this? What is your need to want to start in investing or start a new business? What is the need?
Right.
I think that's the biggest question to ask first, because, you know, and the people that are serious about it will have, you know, a life story or something that changed their course to cause them to reinvent themselves. But people that don't have that need, I see very difficult for them to truly succeed and stay.
Yeah,
in the business.
You know, I tell people, I say, listen, we can sit here all day and you can yes me to death and you can say, yep, that's a great idea, that's great, this and that. And I go, at the end of the day, you're going to walk away. And I said, the reality is nobody cares. Nobody cares what your problems are when you walk away. I hope you're successful and I would give you all the tools that you can. Yeah. But at the end of the day, I've got my own problems. I have my own stuff going on. I care, but I don't care if you don't care more than I do. Meaning, if you don't make it a priority for you, why should I? And I tell people that that's something that you need to focus on when you're trying to do this. You have to get up. I don't, you know, everyone always tells me what you can't do. I tell them, you know, they say, you can't do this, or I don't have time. And I say, you know, it's funny. Everybody tells me what they can't do. Why don't you tell me what you can do? Because you can do it. You can make 100 calls a day. You can do it on your lunch break. You can do it on your pee breaks. You can do it after work. I don't care when you do it. You could do it, but you tell me you can't, and I'm supposed to care. And I don't care if you don't care. And if you want my help, I'll give you all the help in the world. I'll give you the shirt off my back. But you have to care more than I do. And if you don't care more than I do, don't expect me to sit there and wipe the crocodile tears when you're failing and you bought a bad deal because you didn't take the time to learn. And that's the one thing that really I think, because I've touched the hot stove and I've been burnt, and I tell them, you don't want to go down that path, because it is not a fun place to be quote unquote an investor, and you're sitting there in a bad position. And that's the lesson I have for people.
Exactly. That you're absolutely right. I mean, to me, it was like we literally found ourselves in a situation of failure.
Yeah.
But we didn't realize at that moment that was our biggest growth.
Yeah.
We thought, oh my gosh, this is such a failure. We have failed completely. But it was total growth, and it just propelled us to a different level. And we're now grateful and very you know, we are appreciative of what we went through, because we learned from it. And we're in a whole different mindset now.
That's great. Well, Elizabeth, we're out of time, basically. I can't believe an hour's gone by. It's always great. So if they want to get a hold of you, what's a good contact, Facebook, website? How do they do that?
Sure. Okay, so you can look me up, Elizabeth Navarrete, on Facebook. Last name, Navarrete, N-A-V-A-R-R-E-T-E. Or you can look me up by Houston REI Network. I'm on Instagram, on Facebook. And you can also give me a call. My number is 832-614-8832.
All right. And if you want to talk to us at Empire or the self-managed My Property, go to selfmanagemyproperty.com. You can see we've got tons of videos, free forms, documents. We've got the Ultimate Landlord Survival Handbook. If you want to talk to us about property management services, go to EmpireIndustriesLLC.com. And if you want to look us up on Facebook, we have the Landlord Survival Group, which I know you're a part of. We try to share good information. You know, what are the top things that'll get landlords sued? So go to the website, go to our Facebook group. Elizabeth, thank you again for being on the show. I really appreciate it. I'm sure I'll see you out there on the circuit speaking, and we'll talk to
for
you again.
Sure. All right. Thank you, Steve. Appreciate it. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.